Hi, everyone. Welcome to Pipeline, the show where I interview innovative and creative people and learn more about their past, current, and future projects. On this episode, my guest is Chef Lasse Sorensen, who is the owner of Tom's Place in DeSoto, Illinois, and the host of Food is Love, which will be available on YouTube this July. Chef, welcome to Pipeline.
Hi, how are you? Good seeing you.
Good seeing you.
It's been a long time.
It has. I mean, Jane and I were able to get up there, I think it was almost 2 years ago now, to stop in. But before that, prior to that, it had been probably 9 years, I think, 8 or 9 years. So, yeah, it's been a while.
Well, I miss you. You know, you had some fun projects for me up here with the films, the Babette's Feast and the Big Night. Remember that?
Oh, yeah.
That was back in the day. That was fun.
Those were fun. Those were wonderful, wonderful, just great times and great memories. First question I want to ask, though, is how are you and Mary Jane doing? How's everybody doing?
You know, I think under the circumstances, we are doing well. We have our health and we still have our business. And we've been here for 22 years now. So, you know, we've probably been able to weather the COVID pandemic a little bit better than most people just because, you know, we had, you know, set money aside for a rainy day, so to speak. And this is about the worst we've ever seen it in all the years. But we took the time to do a lot of remodeling in the restaurant since, you know, we never have time to do stuff like that. So we've remodeled the restaurant, painted everything, cleaned, and we got rid of a bunch of stuff we never use anymore. So we did like a good spring cleaning. But we are back up and running, and Mary Jane, of course, she got used to not having to work any nights, so she's not so happy right now. She has to come back here and work again. 2 months for a restaurateur not working a night is a long time.
That is. Well, I'm so happy to hear that you've weathered most of the storm and that you had time to make some changes. That's always a smart thing to do. When you have some downtime, so I'm.
But you know, I'm a person that always looks at things in a positive manner, and you know, if I don't have a restaurant anymore because something happens, and not that I think that that's going to happen, but it would never stop me to do something else that makes me happy or cook for somebody. I mean, you know, I would just keep going with something else. So. You know, sometimes when a door closes, another one opens, and then there is something better out there for you. So that's how I always look at it. So I have never, ever thought one moment that we're not going to see a silver lining in what has happened in the last couple of months. Something good's going to come out of it.
That's awesome. That's an awesome attitude to have.
You think as a restaurateur, you know, like all the things that happens with minimum wage hike and all that stuff. They keep throwing things at us. And now the pandemic, you know, what else do they have now? I mean, now they've shown all their cards. I mean, that can't be very much left now they can do.
Yeah.
And if you can handle this, then you're pretty strong going forward, I think.
Yeah, I agree. So as you know, we chatted earlier in the format of this show is I have three main questions.
Okay.
And then we kind of diverge from there and have some fun. So the first question that I have for all my guests is what's a project you've worked on in the last 5, 10 years or so that made you very proud or you learned something from or was very challenging?
I don't know if, you know, like running a restaurant, you know, it makes me proud every day that I'm able to sustain a restaurant in the middle of nowhere in Southern Illinois. And the fact that people drive from, you know, many, many miles away from Chicago, St. Louis, to come down here, and they still come. You know, that's the another reason that keeps me going. And you know, it's a process. Every day you have to be, you know, you have to be an innovator, come up with new ideas, change things around. And you know, more so now than ever, you know, we are constantly trying to adapt to new styles of cuisine and what people want. And the fact that we've been able to adapt to that, and I still think we're doing a really, really good job here. I'm very proud of that. I think that, you know, not only of me, but my wife and my staff, you know, that we've all been able to sustain the clientele that I have, and we've really lately started to focus on younger people. You know, so you know, a couple of years ago I made the bar bigger because I thought that the restaurant was, you know, maybe not casual enough for the younger crowd. They didn't want to dress up or anything, so I kind of built a big bar area that is more for casual dining, and I offer some less expensive offerings in there. And it seems like most of my business now is going in that direction. And that was about 5 years ago we started that, and then we went to a 4-day work week, which my staff really liked because they work 10-hour days, you know, 4 days a week, and we've been very successful with that too. But I think that and one of the new things, I know it's one of your questions too, one of the new things we're doing when this COVID pandemic happened, you know, I was kind of cleaning the restaurant and fixing everything up, and I stood back and I thought to myself, you know, there, I have a 10,000 square foot restaurant. There's a lot of the areas where for months I'm not there, I don't use it. So I have so much capacity that I pay for electricity and air conditioning and everything, and I don't use it. I gotta find a way to start utilizing the place or the space more than I have. So the upstairs, it was really old and hadn't been upgraded, you know, the bathrooms and the place, you know, since the 70s. I decided, well, I'm gonna completely redo that. But then I got this idea, you know, if this pandemic would come back, you know, if you're an essential, you can be open, but if you're in a restaurant, you know, you're not really an essential. So I took the front of the restaurant and I have now made that into a gourmet market. And we don't have that here anymore. There used to be, you know, something similar. The closest to it was Arnold's Market in down in Carbondale, but they're gone now. And so what I'm doing, I got a lot of high-end steaks you can buy. And, you know, like Amish chickens, prime pork, but I also have pastas that are, you know, ready to go, meal kits where you can just, you know, get a fillet, take it home, put it on the grill, and I made you the potatoes, the sauce, and the vegetables. So a lot of that stuff, and, you know, I think that that's going to be a revenue stream for me going forward that's going to be a lot bigger than I would have anticipated, just seeing what's going on now. And, you know, people that are not ready to come up to the restaurant yet, they come in because I'm an essential now. I got permission. So I basically made a little grocery store, but with, you know, food items, you know, so that's going to be interesting to see how that plays out. And I think it'll do real well.
Yeah, that's awesome. That's a great idea. And yeah, I was disappointed to hear my friend Rodney Krenline closed his market, Arnold's. I used to live right across the street from it. Okay. So that was, you know, and I know he was ready to move on. But
crossed my mind too, really. Because if there was really, you know, I've been here for 22 years. If there was a good time to say, you know what, I'm done, you know, let's move on and do something else, this would be the one time, you know, because you didn't go bankrupt and you went out with a you know, where everybody loved your place, and I, it crossed my mind too. And Mary Jane, she really wanted to call it quits. You know, she's a little bit older than I am, and but you know, I'm just not ready yet. You know, I still love what I do, and you know, it's a challenge every day, but you know, that's what keeps me going.
So where did you get the germ for that idea to start a storefront like that?
Well, I mean, you know, actually I got it from, there is a restaurant in St. Louis called Annie Guns, and they have a beautiful market next to the restaurant. And, you know, I've always been a big fan of going in there when I was there for dinner, but I really thought about, you know, when there's so many people that come here on Saturday that says to me, well, I wish you had something we could take home so we don't have to cook tomorrow. So now I have this big display of all these food items. And when you come in and you see it, most likely on the way out, you're going to say, hey, you know, let's take, you know, a couple of lamb chops home. And it's a lot cheaper to buy the lamb chops and make it at home if you don't want to pay the price of a professional chef cooking it for you. Mm-hmm. Or if you just like food and like to play with different things. So this is, you know, not like retail items. This is restaurant quality stuff that I'm carrying. So, you know, I have much better beef than, you know, most people can get. I got prime. But again, so, you know, I want to make sure I don't leave out people that, you know, maybe are not in the category where they can afford, you know, like I have a ribeye this week that is 32 ounce for $85. That's not for everybody. But what I do have, every week I make like a peasant meal, if you will. There's $15. And this week it's a paprika chicken with like a risotto with vegetables in it and toasted almonds. And so that you can get that for $15. So we have two things for $15 every week that's kind of like a peasant meal, or if you just want to pick a couple of dinners up. So I have doctors, for instance, that will call me and they'll order, you know, five or six of these things. So they have them in the refrigerator so they, when they come home from work late, they can just put it in the microwave and heat it up. And then we have the meal kits, of course, too. And I think the fact that not only can I use all the leftovers that I have in the restaurant, you know, which, you know, a lot of times, you know, when you have a 4-day work week, you know, I'm throwing stuff away on Saturday night. It's amazing just because, you know, you can't use it again. And there's a lot of stuff that I can use, but this way here, we've seen that there's, you know, we can do all kinds of stuff with extra stuff we have and make little things where we only had six or seven of them out there, but they sell. So, you know, I think really it's going to work out really good.
That's great. That's great. Now, you know, I know your story, but a lot of our listeners and viewers probably don't know how or why you ended up in Southern Illinois, because, you know, listening to you saying you're adapting to some of the market in Southern Illinois, some of the more casual dining that younger customers may prefer. So if you could share, you know, your how you ended up there, because, you know, I lived there for many years, and you've got, you know, barbecue places, and you've got fast food, and you've got family diners, and, you know, all over Southern Illinois, and you came along and wanted to do this high-end restaurant, and sure people are curious about that.
And that's another thing, you know, when I, basically the restaurant here was, you know, more in tune with what they did in Southern Illinois, and you know, me coming from high-end restaurants in California, I wanted, you know, I came out here and saw what the restaurants did here, and I thought to myself, you know, and I'm not putting anybody down for what they're doing here. I love all the food they have here in Southern Illinois. But, you know, I thought I can carve myself a niche out to have, you know, some really fine dining where you don't have to drive to Chicago or St. Louis. And obviously, as you know, the university for years was one of my biggest customers. And unfortunately, you know, what's going on right now at the university, it don't allow them to eat out as much as they used to. So, but still, you know, I have a strong following of doctors and lawyers. And but right now I'm trying to build a clientele of young people, because it's also important that we educate, you know, the younger people about eating healthy. And when I say healthy, you know, like, you know, I cook with cream and butter, but it's not, you know, it's high quality products I use. And I stress to people, you know, that eats stuff that's called, I can't believe this is not butter. You know, if you look at the label on that stuff, all the chemicals there's in there and everything, everything here is made from scratch out of really, really good products. You know, Amish chicken, you know, like the best beef United States can offer, and lamb from Colorado. But all of those things, you know, we prepare them with no chemicals in there, no preservatives. So you're getting a healthy meal. So even though that I'm, you know, higher priced than a lot of people, that is the price, unfortunately, to eat healthy. You know, all the fast food, you know, you eat, you know, that's not healthy for a lot of different reasons we don't have to go into. But so allow yourself at least once a week to come out and see what a meal looks like. There is made of good ingredients and it's presented to you where it looks good and the service is good. And you allow yourself that as a, you know, a way to say, okay, I had a stressful week. Maybe Friday and Saturday, let's go to Tom's place and have a nice meal like that. And that, you know, that's always how I grew up with it. And, you know, a lot of people has unfortunately forgotten that, you know, that kind of food exists and we should pay more attention to it. And it's interesting because of the show I'm doing in St. Louis, the St. Louis crowd are much more in tune with that than we are in Southern Illinois. It's a really hip food scene in St. Louis. Mm-hmm. And people, even the young people, they're like feeding on new, interesting stuff. I mean, all the new restaurants that is there, all the ethnic choices they have, they love that. And for some reason, you know, it doesn't resonate here in Southern Illinois, but that's what I'm going to try to do. I'm going to try to, you know, have them come up here, hey, try some different stuff.
That's awesome. That's awesome. Now, I have to ask, what I mean, when you, how many years did you say you're celebrating now at Tom's Place?
I've been here for 22 years.
22 years. So what did, when you came up with this idea to carve this niche out, what did your colleagues think? What did Mary Jane think? You know, what?
They thought I was nuts. They thought I was nuts. They said, you'll never make it. But, you know, when your wife tells you it's not going to work, that was the number one drive I had every day. I was going to prove her wrong. And she also told me that, you know, the wine bar that I'm doing now would never work. And that's the biggest moneymaker we have. And the market, she thinks that's a bad idea. And I don't know, that's still out there. But maybe she's doing it now because she knows I'm going to give it 110% if she tells me it's not going to work.
Yeah, she's caught on to you.
But you know, it's good to have somebody that you know, raise the questions all the time. You know, and because, you know, like obviously, like everybody else, I've had a lot of ideas also that didn't work. But you know, you don't learn from having success in everything you do. You learn much more from failure, and you know, where you are down and you have to get up again and keep going, you know.
Exactly.
So I mean, that's kind of how it's been there for a long time. And you know, like there was times in the restaurant business weren't doing so well here that, you know, I dabbled in other things, and that way we made it work, you know.
Mm-hmm. That's great. So great to hear.
And but again, you know, like I can't tell you how many people told me it was not going to work. And, you know, I say after 22 years, you know, it's working. It's working. And, you know, I hope it keeps going.
Are there any plans for a 25th anniversary?
In 2021, the restaurant has been here for 100 years. It was established in 1921. So we are thinking about doing maybe something next year, and hopefully we'll be on a good side of an economy, and we're done with all this political crap and everything. So that would be a great reason to celebrate. And, people are back out again. So let's hope and pray that we get to that point before next year.
Yeah.
Because February of next year, this place has been here for 100 years.
Wow. That's awesome.
So the building, of course, that's another struggle, you know, like we having a building that's 100 years old means that you have constant repairs. And that was the great thing about being closed. And now I say it like it was a positive thing, but I'm sure if the building could talk, it would thank me, because I took care of a lot of stuff that was like 10 years overdue. I mean, plumbing pipes that was held together with duct tape and stuff like that. I mean, you know, we took care of a lot of stuff in these 2 months that we never have time to. Doors that were rotten, you know, all kinds of stuff. So I'm sure the building, she's thanking me right now for doing all that stuff.
That's awesome.
We stopped all the holes where you were in the basement. You could see daylight coming in and all that, you know. But I have a great team of people, you know. They, as soon as we got that PPL loan, of course, I had a few people that didn't want to come back, that wanted to take advantage of just getting unemployment, you know. But you know, the guys that were in the kitchen and some of the staff in the front, they knew that I needed all the help I can get. And, you know, they were right away, even before I had the PPL loan or PPP loan, they said, if you need anything, you know, if whether we are on unemployment or you get that PPP loan, we'll come in and we'll do whatever you want us to do. So the remodeling and all the work we've done here has been a joint effort with all the staff members that has a keen interest in Tom's Place still being here. And I commend them for doing that, because they didn't have to. There's going to be some of the people that, you know, wanted to come back, where I'm going to tell them, no, I have no interest in ever employing you again, because, you know, your attitude really showed this time around, and we don't need you here. I would much rather take some of the people from other restaurants that are closing down that has a nice attitude and bring them in here, because, you know, this team I have, you know, they really showed up for me. Mm-hmm. And with all the other endeavors I'm doing right now, I'm not in the restaurant, you know, 3 days a week. So I really need to have somebody I can trust, and they've done an incredible job.
Well, that speaks volumes of the respect and love they have for you, Chef. I think that's apparent. That's so awesome to hear that they're willing to do that.
And, yeah.
Yeah, that's awesome.
I'm very lucky, you know, and, you know, it's, you know, and just like everybody else, it's not like I'm giving out money left and right, but, you know, I give them a good wage, and I give them an opportunity to learn a lot of stuff here. And, you know, they get an education while they're here, and they get to see a lot of fun things. And, you know, I think that pays off for some people that, you know, it's not always about money. You know, it's also about, you know, you are loving what you're doing. And, you know, when I have more money again later, if we keep going, you know, I'm going to show my gratitude to those people and, you know, put them in positions where they make more money, because they've really deserved it, you know.
That's
all. They've showed when times were tough, we're here for you. And, you know, when things get better again, you know, I'm going to say, you know, I remember when you were here for me. So, you know, here it is.
Very good. That's awesome. So what is, and maybe you've talked a little bit about it, but maybe there's something else, but what's a current project that you're working on right now that's been very engaging for you?
Well, my current project right now is, I got, I have a friend out in Los Angeles, in Hollywood, Julie Chen, who is, she's the host of Big Brother.
Mm-hmm.
She invited me out on a show out there, and I was on the talk that she was also a host of at the time. She's no longer there on that show, but that kind of gave me a bug about this TV. And as you remember, Amy Shaw, years ago, I did a show with her, River to River Region, or Chefs of the River Region. And then after that, I started working with WSIU. So for 10 years, I did a lot of TV with them. So I kind of got the bug real bad when I was out there in California, and I was talking to my friend Julie about it. And, they all told me, getting your own show is so difficult. And only 1% are going to make it and all that stuff. And it started sounding like, the same thing my wife's telling me. And I'm like, really? Okay. So I had this idea, and believe it or not, when I'm saying I'm actually doing it my own show now, but the idea sprung from all the diversity we have in the world. And, I've seen my customers. I try to stay clear of anybody's, political opinions or religion or sexual orientation. That stuff, as a restaurateur, you got to be real careful with. But that doesn't mean that I don't listen to my customers. You have one on the one side of the bar yelling at the other one at the other side of the bar. And I could see the yelling and screaming stopped once they had something to eat and they got something to drink. The conversation became more, pleasant and human. And it gave me the idea for a show. I thought to myself, food is really a peacemaker. Food is love, because deep down, it doesn't matter who you are, where you're from, what race or anything. We all have the same needs for food. Or wine or social contact around food. It is really, really an important part of all of our cultures and life. And I have different groups of people that I probably would never consider in the past sitting down with. And I thought to myself, some of those groups of people, I don't have to mention who they were, but I'm going to try to establish some kind of communication or inviting people that are different than me and have some meals with them and see, what's their point of view on food and why are they cooking these things? Is it your mom and dad that taught you this? Did they have you sitting every Sunday at home for a meal? All of those things is my show is just about that. It's called Food is Love. And what I'm not the star of the show. The people that are on the show with me are the star of the show. So the first episode, I go to a Korean chef, and I don't know anything about Korean cuisine, none. And he teaches me some of the things that he are really proud of in his place, Korean fried chicken, and we talk about the story about how did that all come about, how did that come to America, and how did it eventually end up in St. Louis, and what was his interest in food before he started the restaurant, and so I dig deep down in these stories, and food for chefs like me and like the people that I interview. This is as close to our heart as you can get is food. So they have some incredible stories to tell. And those are the stories I'm looking for in my show. And also in the same room, I'm educating other people that not necessarily wanted to go to a Korean restaurant because they didn't know about it or they didn't, there's always some fear of the unknown or things that are not, you're not comfortable with. But so I'm trying to bridge that where people would say, you know what, that food looks really interesting and he looks like a wonderful person. Let's go try his restaurant. So that's the kind of show it is. And like Amy Shaw, if I can quote her, she told me that it's a love letter to St. Louis and St. Louis restaurants. And I think that it really sums it up. And so that's my project, and we've done 3 episodes so far, I just finished the 4th episode yesterday. And when I say finished, that means my part of it. Now the editor and actually I wanted to go back and tell you about how this came about, because it's an interesting story. And again, everybody told me you'll never get your own show and only 1% and all that. But it just seems like somebody was looking down and wanting me to do this. So when I was on my way back from California, I got a phone call from Jack Galmich. He used to be the CEO at Nine Network. And he called me, and I was sitting in the cab on the way home, and I thought to myself, this is unbelievable. I get a phone call from a network in St. Louis the day I'm flying home after I did that show in St. Louis, in Los Angeles. And I'm like, that's almost an omen. So we arranged a meeting, and this is about 2 years ago. We arranged a meeting, and then I came up with the idea for the show, and he thought it was a wonderful idea. It was very, very supportive, and meeting after meeting after meeting, and time flies. So it was a long time, really, and then all of a sudden, Jack passed away, and I was like, wow, this is not good, I had met Amy in one of the meetings, and she said, "What are you doing here?" And I told her, "What are you doing here?" I didn't know she worked up there, and so when Amy took over, she's like, "Okay, we're gonna do it, and let's just go." And she's been just a great supporter of the idea of the show and everything. So we produced a pilot. And she said, we'll take 13 episodes. So wow. that was really a pat or a feather in my cap. But I can't take credit for it all myself, because I've been working on another TV show down here in Southern Illinois that I was doing some cooking segments. And I met a producer, his name is Jason Pinkston, and he was a big fan of Anthony Bourdain. Mm-hmm. And I never watched cooking shows, which actually now turns out to be a really good thing, because I don't do anything that everybody else is doing, because I don't have anything to say, okay, well, I really like what he did, so I'm gonna do the same thing. So yeah. I'm happy I never watched the shows, just because once, when you're around food all day, do you really want to go home and watch cooking shows? No. And a lot of that stuff, is made up. And so I just never had any intentions of doing anything like that. So this style is perfect for me, what we're doing. And Jason wanted to do some kind of documentary style show around food. So we were really a perfect matchup. And he's incredibly talented. Look at me. He makes me look good. Now, that takes a lot of editing. So he's doing all that. And, I'm so grateful that we met each other. And I'm sure that, we're entering a golden era for both of us. It's his time to shine. He's been in Southern Illinois for a long time. And, it's time for him to step up to a new, a new arena. And we have gotten support from Julie Chen, and she's now also a producer on our show.
Awesome.
So So you can imagine how we feel. We have the backing from Julie Chen Moonves. She's an executive producer, and Jason is executive producer. So that kind of puts us far ahead in a lot of different areas. And it just shows that, you know, obviously we're still in the time where we need to like fine polish what we're doing. But the idea we have, somebody's looking at this show and saying, this is a really, really good idea, including Amy and including Julie. And they're saying, this is something, this is going to be something, this is going to be a great show. So I'm very, very proud of what we've done so far. And Jason's, you know, skills where it's not only food that we're doing. I mean, it's the personal story and it's the cinematography that he puts in there. It makes it a very unique show.
That is awesome. That
and
is-
it'll air on the Nine Network at 7:30. It's a Monday on July 13th, the first episode, and I it'll be available for streaming on YouTube. I'm sure. So I'll keep you posted on that.
That's awesome. Well, yeah. You know, Amy is so wonderful to work with. She's been a guest on this show, and I'm so glad you're working with her. I don't know Jason or Julie personally, but it's wonderful that you have them working with you.
Well, you know, I get some really, really, really good advice. Mm-hmm. This is a brand new job for me. You know, I'm trying to carry a show like that where, you know, I got, you know, three or four camera guys, you know, following me around in St. Louis. So I have a lot to learn. The advice I'm getting is really good. And it's a learning curve, you know, and I'm sure if we get into a second season, I'm sure the show's going to get better and better because we're all getting better of doing our jobs. So,
well, that leads me to a question then. So, you know, I know how much you love creating beautiful, delicious meals for people. And if this takes you out of the kitchen, how are you going to find that balance?
You know, I haven't crossed that bridge yet because you remember my wife told me this TV show is never going to go anywhere. So let's wait and see what happens. And it could also mean that all of a sudden people would travel from St. Louis down to the restaurant that then would require me to spend more time in the restaurant. I don't know. You know, it's one of those things that it'd be a good problem to have.
Right.
But we kind of have to wait and see where it's going to fall. But the 4-day work week is working out really well because I'm able to film, Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, and then come back on Wednesday. And we've been able to do the segments we've made in that time frame. And that, so I open up today, Wednesday, and then I'm here, through Saturday. That part of it is okay if we can keep that schedule going.
Good, good.
But the interesting thing about the show, when you talk about, you know, me creating stuff, and so I visit these chefs and I get these, I get to experience what they do, and I learn some new things and I get exposed to new ingredients. So the last 5 minutes of the show is me coming back to Tom's place, and I basically take what I was shown or taught or the inspiration I got from these other chefs, and I built my own dish for the restaurant out of what they taught me or the inspiration I got from looking at them cooking. So I'm still doing, something like that on the show, and that's my time to shine, where I get to do some fun stuff.
That's awesome.
Yeah. Awesome. But that's filmed down here at Tom's place. So I'm still, even though it's a St. Louis show, I'm still showcasing a restaurant in Southern Illinois.
Wow. Well, and does Jason live down there?
Jason, it just so happens that he lives in Hearst.
Oh.
Which is 10 minutes away. So when he comes over, and if we need to look at editing and stuff, we're so close to each other. So it really just, everything just worked perfectly. I mean, it was meant to be. All of this stuff is just working out so good. And I mean, you know, I consider myself extremely fortunate and lucky that you know, I got this opportunity. And, you know, every time I see Amy, I thank her. And every time I talk to Julie Chen Moonves, I thank her, because, you know, the encouragement you have to get from people like that in order to even think about doing this. And some of my friends, a very dear friend of mine, he owns a company called Wild Alaskan Salmon and Seafood. And you should have him on your show, because he's a great innovator too.
Captain Tony?
Yeah, Captain Tony, yeah. I in the beginning, we started the show, I didn't have any money, and, you know, we were opening a bottle of whiskey, and we were sitting talking about it and everything, and he said, you know what, I know you're going to give me the money back, and, you know, he said, I would hate for this show not to, you know, materialize, so he gave me the money to get started, and I just paid him back a week ago. Even though I told him I would give him the money back 10 days later, and that's almost a year ago. But that's the kind of friendships we have, and those are the best kinds of friendship. You know, he always believed in the show, and now he's now the sponsor of the show. So before and after the show, you'll see Captain Tony's come up, and I mean, not only is he a great businessman and he has a wonderful product that I use in the restaurant, but he's also a great friend that like supported me and knew how difficult it was doing all this stuff, especially with all this COVID. So I've been doing a lot of collaborations with him, and I'm thinking that we are probably going to collaborate on a lot of different things. We have a lot of things in the pipeline we're wanting to do together, because if you think about what we're doing, you know, he fishes his own fish, and he cuts it, processes it, and sells it himself. So you know this is good stuff. It's not turned around in another country and come back here, and it's all, you know, sustainable. And it plays right into what I do as a chef and what I believe in as a chef. So we have the, you know, the fisherman and the chef. I mean, this will be a great venture that we're embarking on together too. So that's going to be, when you interview me in a couple of years again, I'll tell you all about all the things that we're talking about doing together. But that's going to be another project of mine in the future. That's in the pipeline.
That's in the pipe. That was the next question. That's the project in the pipeline, huh?
Yeah, we're talking about doing some stuff on the internet together, where we are kind of joining forces on what we do and what we can offer people in terms of, you know, great products and knowledge that we have together. So I think that we'll have something in the next year or so that's going to be unique to us. So,
now, how did you meet Captain Tony?
It's been 20 years. I think he probably came to the restaurant. We had a few drinks too many together, and it just stuck. You know, when you meet good people, you know they're good. You know, and especially, you know, the ones that, you know, we just have seen each other for years, and you know he lives in Alaska half of a year, and down here in Southern Illinois, where you have a facility, a distributing center down here, and actually I went to Alaska last year, where he invited us up there. Jason was with me too, and we shot a commercial for him up there. So if you check out his website, I don't know if I can mention his website on your show. But Wild Alaska Salmon and Seafood if you look at that website, and they have pictures of me fishing there, and I was on the boat with him fishing, and we did a lot of stuff up there together, and you know, it was a great experience, and I'm sure I'll be back again.
That's awesome. That's awesome.
That's one of those that's one of those friendships where we're probably going to be sitting on some front porch together when we're really old and reminiscing of all these things. We are saying with the pandemic, you know, you always hear about people saying, well, I survived this war, or the depression and all that. Now we have something too that we can say, you know, this was a tough one too, and we made it through, and you know, because we have that can-do attitude, the American can-do attitude, even though I'm Danish. You know, it's a combination of those two things, the Danish can-do attitude and the American can-do attitude.
That's so awesome to hear. That is so awesome. I had no idea you and Tony had that relationship and that was in the works. So I'm looking forward to seeing that down the pipeline. But I hope... you know, like you said, in a year or two, I hope we can revisit and find.
Yes, absolutely. And I hope, you know, some of your viewers or listeners will, on Instagram, you can check out the Food is Love TV on Instagram. There's already a trailer for the show there where you can see some of it we are doing. And there'll be updates on when everything is going to come out.
Great.
But it's a really good show, and you know, it just so happened right now that's what the world needs. They need a unifier, and I'm not claiming I'm the unifier, but the food is the unifier, and that's why food is love.
That's awesome, Chef. I cannot wait to get back to Southern Illinois to see you, Mary Jane, and sit down and have some of Captain Tony's salmon at Tom's place. And really looking forward to seeing your YouTube show, Food is Love.
Yeah, it's on the Nine Network. It's a PBS affiliate, so it'll be on the PBS in three states up here in the Midwest. But then it'll be available on YouTube after it airs.
Excellent. Well, Chef, thank you so much for joining me. I really appreciate you taking the time.
You're very welcome.
I know you've got a lot, very much going on, and I really appreciate it. And then, like I said, I hope you'll visit us again, and I hope we're able to come up and visit you.
I have a dream. I've never been to Texas because I wanted to see if everything is bigger in Texas.
Well, I've gotten bigger, I will say that. But I really encourage you to come to Houston. You mentioned you're exploring diversity and food, and Houston is amazing. We have so much diversity with regard to ethnicities and them bringing their cuisines, and it's all over town. It's just amazing. I would love to show you around.
In my connection to Houston, one of the other people that has been encouraging me along for the show and also have helped me in a lot of different ways with the show in the beginning, with a lot of the you know, financial obstacles and all of that stuff, is his name is Rob Kirkland, and he's actually from Houston. He's now the CEO of Cisco in St. Louis. So that's my little Houston connection. And I also tell him, I said, you know, you need to take me to Houston someday, you know, and but, you know, he's been, you know, I always tell him, you know, there's only two board of directors on the show. Now there's a little more now since we got going. But at the beginning, it was only him and I, because he was also one of these people that really believed in it, you know, with Amy. So, you know, I want to thank him a lot, too, for helping me out. And he's just a great person. And, you know, he's from your town, Houston. And, you know, I will pay Cisco back by, if they ever need any help or they wanted anything, wanted a chef to do something for him, I would do all that, because, you know, he's taken his free time and helped me with all this stuff. And that's been great. And that's, again, you know, It's not what you know, it's who you know, and it's when you make those connections, it's how you treat those people, because if you treat them the right way, you know, karma will help you, and things are gonna work out for you. So, again, I'm blessed and grateful, all of these great friends that's helped me.
Yeah, well, Chef, thank you for treating us so well. I'm sure there's a lot of great karma coming your way. And
well, thank you.
Please stay in touch, and let's visit again. Thank you so much. Bye-bye.
Bye.